Hello, good morning, and very welcome along to Ireland AM here on Virgin Media One.
Yes, indeed. Over the next 3 hours, we're waking you up with good grub, great guests, and gorgeous getaways.
Oh, yeah, guess who's getting on the getaways, your man? The international traveller over there. Coming up, we're going to be speaking to the author who's challenging the health benefits of plant-based eating.
Plus,
I'm really looking forward to that.
Yeah, I'm sure you are.
To see the other side of it. Because everything is
chicken
always
is
plant-based,
a vegetable
plant-based.
To you.
It kind of is, actually.
Yeah. Maybe we'll learn something. Plus, from minions to menacing masks, we'll be running through this week's film hits and misses.
And how much do you tip? Do you carry cash anymore?
Not really. I find I don't have it.
Exactly. It's hard to tip now, I think, with contactless all the time. Shortly, we're going to find out why service charges on bills could soon be a thing of the past.
And if that's
do you
not
tip,
enough,
let us know at home, 0896 111 111. How much is enough now?
How much is enough? And if that's not enough for you, our resident globetrotter, our Maltese falcon, Alan Hughes, is taking us to sunnier climes. Alan.
Yes, Grainne, later in the show, we'll be looking at part two of my Malta adventure, where I'll be exploring their neighbouring ancient island of Gozo. Now, Derek, where in the world are you this morning?
Yes, indeed, Al, from Gozo to Glasnevin.
There you go.
It's a pretty showery start out there, especially across the eastern half of the country. Some thundery action on the way out there today as well. But if we swing the camera around, we are joined by all the girls here. It's going to be a morning of powerlifting with all the ladies. It's all about girl power. We've got mammies, we've got grannies, we've even got...
Great grannies,
there you go. So we're asking, Grainne, can you show us your guns? Show us your guns, girls. Come on. Hey. Come on, Grainne.
Derek,
we want to see your guns.
Fair play to you, Derek. It looks like you've
women.
Been working out already. Look at the sweat on them
fair
already.
Fair play.
They are raring to go. All right, girls, yeah!
They really are. I reckon they want to stop the camera now because their arms are getting tired having
not
to do
that. Not at all. They can go on more than they will.
Great stuff. Love, Derek. Puts a smile on our face every morning. But now let's get over to the Virgin Media News Hub. Good morning, Anne O'Donnell.
Good morning. Thanks, Tommy. The US is set to boost its military presence in Europe after NATO declared Russia the most significant and direct threat to its members' peace and security. The military alliance is also planning to beef up its defences in response to what NATO's chief has called the biggest security crisis since World War II. Well, Moscow has described the announcement as destabilising and has said it will respond in kind to any military build-up in Sweden and in Finland.
Russia shares footage of its military units, which it claims are striking army strongholds and armoured vehicles in Ukraine, while the president of the war-torn country shared this footage, claiming it shows Moscow targeting civilians in Kremenchuk. That attack formed the backdrop for an historic NATO summit in Madrid, where the military alliance formally offered membership to Finland and Sweden. The Nordic nations applied to join as they grew more and more concerned about their increasingly aggressive neighbour. And leaders from Australia, Japan, South Korea and New Zealand joined the summit for the first time ever, as it revealed a new strategic concept to confront what it says is its biggest security crisis since World War II. A strengthened NATO is exactly the kind of outcome that Vladimir Putin would have hoped to avoid when he invaded Ukraine more than 4 months ago. Hannah Murphy, Virgin Media News.
The Taoiseach was among world leaders attending an informal NATO dinner in the Prado Art Museum in Madrid. His attendance to the NATO event was criticised by some opposition TDs given Ireland's neutrality. However, Micheál Martin said it was important to maintain solidarity and cooperation between like-minded partners given the threat posed by Russia's military aggression. The lone survivor of a team of Islamic State extremists who terrorised Paris in 2015 was convicted of murder and other charges and also sentenced to life in prison without parole for the deadliest peacetime attacks in French history. Salah Abdeslam was given France's most severe sentence possible for his part in the coordinated attacks that claimed the lives of 130 people in the Bataclan concert hall and in other venues on that day. Well, survivors and victims' families have been giving their reaction to the sentence after emerging from the courtroom following the nine-month trial.
At the end, he asked for pardon. And he cried also, and I don't think it's possible to give him to pardon him. It's not possible because he doesn't have... I consider that he didn't express any real remorse.
R&B singer R. Kelly was sentenced to 30 years in prison for using his fame to sexually abuse young fans. Several of Kelly's accusers told a court that he had preyed on them and misled his fans. The Grammy winner didn't speak at his sentencing and showed no visible reaction on him hearing his penalty, which also includes a $100,000 fine. Outside the court, some of R. Kelly's victims gathered to welcome the sentence.
There wasn't a day in my life up until this moment that I actually believed that the judicial system would come through for black and brown girls. I stand here very proud of my judicial system, very proud of my fellow survivors, and very pleased with the outcome.
Today was a very special but hard day for us. I personally, this happened to me a long time ago. I was 17, I'm 45 today. I never thought that I would be here to see him be held accountable for the atrocious things that he did to children.
Back home, Gardaí are to conduct a full cold case review into the murder of Sophie Toscan du Plantier. The French woman was killed in her home in West Cork in 1996. It follows a review by the Assistant Commissioner, Organised and Serious Crime and the Gardaí Serious Crime Review Team. Recommendations are to be provided to the local investigation team. Gardaí say the investigation into Sophie's murder has remained active and ongoing. And the suspected driver of a truck in Texas has been charged after 53 migrants were found dead inside the vehicle. That brings to four the number of people arrested and charged in connection with what has been described as the deadliest human smuggling incident in the US. According to Mexican authorities, 27 of the victims were from Mexico, 14 were from Honduras, 7 from Guatemala and 2 were from El Salvador. Efforts to identify the dead are being complicated by a lack of identification documents, the need to share fingerprint data across borders and even stolen IDs.
For car insurance, van insurance or home insurance, call the Quote Devil. Unless, of course, you've got money to burn.
Yes, thanks very much, Amory. It's all about girl power here this morning because we're here with the powerlifting ladies of Glass Never. Watch them go. And we're going to be catching up with some of the crew in a little while. So a quick look at weather now. We'll take an opening look, in fact, as we get into the last day of June. Oshie Moore with us now on cameras this Thursday morning. And it's a very wet start through the eastern half of the country. Some heavy rain coming down at the moment. But elsewhere, it is a lot drier with some bright spells pulling through in those light westerly breezes now. In fact, right across this afternoon, it looks like, again, some heavy rain on the way. Some of that will be thundery in nature as well. So do keep an eye on your pets. And again, quite heavy, quite humid in terms of those temperatures with top valleys of about 15 to 19 degrees. Finally then, tonight, it looks like mainly dry for a time, but again, some light rain, light drizzle edging in across those western coastal counties. But an improving picture then as we edge our way into your Friday morning with overnight lows back to about 7 to 11 degrees. So that's your weather for now here in Das 7. We'll catch you again back live at 7.35. Well done, girl.
For first-time drivers, young drivers, returning drivers, if you've had an open claim or have had too many penalty points. The Quote Devil's always got one hell of a
quote. Time now to take a look at this morning's paper, starting with the Irish Times. And its headline reads, pressure mounts for early budget in September. The budget could be brought forward by up to a month by the government as it faces significant pressure from the opposition about the cost of living crisis.
Sophie, cold case, new witnesses, key to probe. That's the front page of the Irish Independent. Improvements in DNA testing and new witness statements have prompted Gardaí to launch a cold case review into the murder of Sophie Toscan du Plantier.
The Examiner leads with COVID threats loom over holiday plans. COVID is threatening to throw the travel plans of holidaymakers into disarray this summer. It already has, as cases surge across Europe, leaving airlines with no option but to cancel flights.
The Herald goes with witnesses hold key to fresh Sophie probe.
And the Mirror goes with new Sophie murder probe.
The Sun leads with cold case cops to revisit Sophie murder.
Parents are now skipping dinners is the top story from the Daily Mail. Families are struggling to put food on the table as a new study reveals grocery prices here are amongst the highest in Europe.
And finally, the Star leads with Basket Case of Europe. Irish shoppers are stumping up nearly a fifth more than the Eurozone average for food and double the average for booze. Wow. We're going to be looking into that and delving further into the main stories in this morning's papers coming up very shortly.
And do you tip? And if you do, do you know where your tip is going? We're going to be talking about that new law that proposes a ban on service charges right after this.
You're going to love that.
Because the stories making the headlines in the morning papers is Lorcan Nyan from the Communications Clinic. Good morning, Lorcan.
Morning, Lorcan. Good to have you with us again. I think we're going to have to start with this story at the front of a lot of the papers this morning, the reopening of the cold case of Sophie Toscante-Plantier. I suppose for people who maybe aren't aware of this case, which I'm sure most people are, have you got a brief kind of synopsis of where this all started again?
And look, I think most people would be aware of it because, you know, there has been the True Crime podcast.
Huge.
There has been
and
you know,
two documentaries.
I haven't watched any of them. But, look, it was a murder in West Cork. French woman living in West Cork, very, very brutal murder, and look, has been consistently in the headlines since then. And so their case has been ongoing again and again and again. And Ian Bailey, who was living in the area, has been charged by this in Paris and in France. Mm. They've tried him here. While here, he's, you know, talked to Gardaí about it, but consistently
maintains his innocence
and will consistently do that. So the guards have looked at this twice since then. They've looked at the investigation at the time. Twice since then, they've reopened it, and now they're looking at reopening it again. Primarily, there are two drivers to that. Number one is the fact that because of new technology, they think that they might be able to, from the DNA, be able to go deeper into the murder weapon, which was a block in the blood that's in it, and maybe be able to extract more from that and therefore learn more from there. But also because of the podcast, the True Crime, etc., there's been a lot of focus on it. And it looks like, and the independent seems to be reporting, that there may be new witnesses coming forward. There may be people willing to talk that weren't willing to talk previously. Mm. So they're going to relook at it. They're going to reopen it again. This is something that the guards do to cold cases. They look at it again when there is new evidence or when there is new reasons to look. And Ian Bailey and his solicitor had welcomed this reopening of the investigation.
Sophie's son did come to Ireland last year to plead for, you know, anybody who might have had information to come forward. And as we know, loyalties change and relationships change over time. It's interesting that a witness has come forward now, almost after things have died down, really, because there was a frenzy of publicity around the two documentaries and a lot of attention at the time.
Absolutely. And look, we don't know necessarily the timeline of when this happened and when the guards were talking and when they were moving through it, but there was a huge amount of focus. But there always has been a huge amount to focus on in Ireland. It's never really fully gone away from the headlines. And I think when you hear the son speak, you really do just hope that for absolutely everybody involved in this, that they do manage to find some closure from it. Because until you get that closure, it is very difficult. And he doesn't want to be travelling to Ireland to talk about this and bring it forward, do you know?
Yeah.
And so, look, if this new investigation can bring forward some truth to it, I think that would obviously be very, very welcome.
And again, it brings, I mean, Ian Bailey, again, is a man who's always been in the spotlight with this, who has maintained his innocence, and he's actually reacted by saying, this is what I've been asking and calling for over 12 months ago. I am therefore clearly delighted to hear that my request has been accepted, acceded to as well. Mm. So this cold case, I mean, listen, it's a real blot in Irish history, isn't it? And to try and find, if DNA and modern science can find a way to find out who was the murderer, it would be a huge statement of intent.
Yeah, look, and it is a blot, and it's a blot, obviously, because, you know, France haven't let this go.
No, I mean,
this was mentioned by Macron in a visit over here. I mean, it is consistently quite front of mind in France, which means, look, for whatever about the moral reasons, but we need to find this out, and is a blot, and it wasn't, you know, perhaps handled as well as it could possibly be for the international relations piece as well. I mean, it is consistently in focus, and I think the guards would absolutely love to be able, for many, many reasons, to be able to finally look into
it. And particularly with the likes of Netflix and stuff do a documentary on it.
Yeah.
You know, it brings worldwide focus on it. And
huge
actually,
attention.
When you looked at that documentary, it was pretty damning on the Gardaí as well. I mean, to how late it took to get the evidence and everything else in it as well. So listen, we will find out in due course what comes out of that as well.
Something else that's in the news,
which is no surprise again,
and doesn't leave our attention, is the cost of living.
Yeah.
And in particular at the moment, the cost of food in this country.
Yeah, so the CSO, coming out of a Eurostat report, has looked at the cost of food, alcohol, tobacco in all the Eurozone countries as well as against the EU 27 countries. And I think you'll see from the headlines that we do not rank particularly well when it comes to being compared to the EU average and to the rest of the Eurozone. I think one of the things to realise about this is even pre all the inflation, Ireland was very, very expensive. Mm-hmm. I mean, so we're if you take everything into account, it's us in Denmark at this stage, where we are the most expensive countries to live in. That was pre-inflation, which means obviously then when you get the fuel impacts on top of it and you get the current inflationary pressure that's, you know, globally, we then get impacted much worse. And so while it is global pressure, the fact that our base wasn't brilliant in the first place means we get impacted more. So the focus today is on food. When you delve into the figures, and I think it's probably important to have a bit of context for people. I mean, on some of the staples, the headline figure is that we're the second most expensive in the EU.
Yeah.
But if you look into, you know, some of the figures, we're lower on meat. We're about 11th of the EU 27 when it comes to meat. Yeah. On veg, we're 8. Bread, we're 8. Milk, we're about 8th as well. So a lot of the staples were not that high. And the still major driver of the cost of living crisis in Ireland is housing and fuel. So that still is the major driver, but in areas here, we're obviously not
the likes of meat, though, milk, cheese, are things that are very much can be manufactured in Ireland.
Yes.
So there are things that you would think that there shouldn't be a massive price on. We're not have to import them hugely into this country, see it hope.
But we also make alcoholic drink in this country.
Well, what about alcohol?
That is very expensive.
Like, this is the funny thing. Whenever people think of Ireland, they always think, "Ah, they love a drink, and you know, you have pints, whatever else, and people enjoy the crack coming over here." But it's insane how much we charge people and tourists coming in, and our own everybody who lives in the country.
Yeah, and look, a huge amount of that is driven by government policy, and I think maybe you've identified the reason why the government policy is there, Tommy, is because perhaps we love a drink and we're known for it, and therefore the government
we're
is using
to be
taxes.
Correct. Crack though, aren't we? Is that such a bad thing?
The government has decided that kind of long ago that between taxes and now that they brought in minimum unit pricing, that the way to reduce the amount of alcohol that we drink is, you know, again, if you're talking about EU averages, we do tend to be quite high on those EU averages when it comes to consumption, is driving by price. Look, the jury is out whether that works, whether, you know, that the minimum unit pricing is the way forward for it. But a lot of the headlines here, a lot of the fact that we're very, very high on some of these figures, where we are, you know, high overall on food as well, is driven by alcohol. And a lot of alcohol is driven directly by taxes as well as the minimum unit pricing.
Do you think, you know, there's talk about budgets and budgets coming early with the amount of pressure on people. Do you think they could ever consider walking back that tax take that they have on alcohol at the moment? Because it's pretty new what they've done.
Yeah, so I suppose the taxes have just consistently increased budget on budget, and then the minimum unit pricing is very, very new. Mm-hmm. And look, we were modelling it on Scotland. There are reports coming out in Scotland on, you know, it's been successful in some ways, but in some of the major ways it hasn't been. Will they dial it back on the tax line? Probably no, because once you dial it back, you don't dial it back up again, most likely, or it takes you a while to. So they're quite unlikely to. And I think the way to address the cost of living crisis is just to reduce the price of alcohol is not something that they would put forward, because again, when you look at the overall figures,
we'd be a bit more crack though.
Yeah. We'd be a bit more crack, wouldn't we? Yeah. But when you're thinking how much we're having to pay on drink, no wonder we're not tipping anymore. That's our next story we're going to be talking about as well. Lorcan Nyan from the Communications Clinic, thank you so much for joining us to talk about that. We've plenty more Ireland AM coming up after the break.
Now, the government is debating a new law which aims to prevent the hospitality industry imposing a service charge unless it goes straight to the staff.
Joining us now to discuss this is employment law expert Richard Grogan and on Skype, CEO of the Restaurants Association of Ireland, Adrian Cummins. We're going to come to you first, Richard. The changes being brought in, what's being proposed exactly? Because a lot of people are confused about this.
Right.
Customers going into restaurants, for instance.
At the present time, you go in and you get your meal, and then you get a service charge. And you say, well, that's the tip that's going to the staff. Mm. That's not going to the staff. Most of the time, that's going straight to the restaurant. So you think that you've given it, that that's your tip. It isn't your tip, because this is money that has been taken under the guise of a service charge as really just an additional charge to you. And what I would say to you, as I said it before, if you walked in to buy a suit, in a shop, and you pick out a suit for €250 and somebody has shown you it and helped you along, and you go up to the cashier and they say, that's €275. And you say, no, it says 250. And you went, but there was a service charge. Well, you'd be straight out the door.
Absolutely.
And you'd be on social media. Well, don't go in there because mm-hmm. now we've had this service charge. It's been there. It has just been an additional charge. So instead of charging somebody €15 for their meal, it was actually €16.50 because of the service charge. And that's the problem.
But you see, Richard, I would always be, and like I'm sure lots of people watching this morning, I'd be in a restaurant and I'd be looking at that and I'd sort of say, oh, 12% service charge, that's grand, so we won't tip them now. It's all included and it makes a life a lot easier. Mm. So you're saying that I always thought that went to the staff, but it doesn't. Well, it goes to the staff to help maybe bump up their wages, but not necessarily to get into their to give them as a tip.
Well, you are always wrong, which is good to know. And yes, it was used to pay their wages, not necessarily to bump up their wages. So if you're on €10 an hour, the tips came in, you still ended up on €10 an hour.
Because when you see that, I don't know very many people who would think they're giving 12%. And then give another 12% as a tip. It means you're giving over 20% of what the cost of your meal is.
Look, this was just a way of putting a price on and then hiding an additional cost rather than setting it out. And if you're going down to a restaurant, you'd be much happier if you walk outside and you're looking at the menu and you say, that's the cost of a steak. Yes, that's it.
That's it.
That's it, I can see. And you go in, that's the cost of steak, that's the cost of a bottle of wine. And you go in, you don't want to do, you've totted it up and it comes to €90 and it then find out suddenly that it's come to 105 because of a service charge. The service charge was not going to staff, and this is to mean that it will go to staff. If it's paid through the credit card, the new legislation is going to say that goes to staff on top of their wages, not is part of the wages, it's on top.
Mm. Adrian Cummins of the Restaurants Association of Ireland. This will be, you know, people watching, this will be a bit of a revelation. There will be many of us who would have assumed that's tip and it's not. And clarity has to be welcome, doesn't it?
Good morning. So first of all, we welcome the legislation as an association. It brings, as you said, Grainne, it brings clarity to where we are for consumers. So we have tips, gratuities and service charge. What we're talking about this morning is service charge, which is the new addition to the bill.
But people will have thought that's all the same thing, a tip, gratuity and a service charge. People will have been under the impression that was all the one.
Well, you know, people may have thought that, but what we need to do now is make sure that every consumer knows exactly what their, you know, the terms and conditions are, what a service charge is when they're going to a restaurant. This legislation means that 100% of service charge must go to staff that is collected. Now, the Taoiseach did say that if a restaurant wanted to have a group booking charge, they can have a group booking charge, which is a business cost to the business. That's up to each individual business if they wanted to bring that in. So you might have at busy times of the year, at Christmas, you know, pre-COVID, you would have seen groups of six or more, depending on whatever the business was, or 10 or more, they might have had a charge for a group booking. Mm. And that can be allowed in the future. But, you know, this is a good day for staff as well. We agree with that. We want to make sure that all the staff get what's entitled to them. But the most important thing as well is, and I want to make it clear, that all of these tips and gratuities and whatever is collected is taxed at the end of the day. And you know that's important that we educate the consumers that if you leave €10, that will be taxed, and the full €10 doesn't go to the staff. They get it less whatever tax due to the state.
But Adrian, so this is good news for the workers, but is it good news for the owners? What's the feedback from owners of restaurants? And do you know that they have been using this service charge to basically supplement workers' wages?
Well, I haven't heard that, to tell you the truth.
You haven't? As CEO of the Restaurant Association, you haven't heard that no restaurant in Ireland supplements the service charge to pay workers?
No workers has created, or not created, but has come to us with the issue at hand, which is a specific restaurant that is a member of the association. So, you know, I can only deal with the members that I represent. But, you know, the Taoiseach there, we've had engagement with them around this, that we want the legislation to go through as quickly as possible. And we want to make sure there's clarity to this so that everybody knows exactly what a tip, what a gratuity, what a service charge is at the end of the day.
Richard, what do you make of that?
I've had loads of employees come on to me and say to me, I'm working in the restaurant industry, there's a service charge, I don't get the service charge. And I would say to them, you aren't entitled to it. That went straight into the till. And they said, but... So, I mean, all right, I understand...
But none of Adrian's members do it, according to Adrian.
Well, I think the position in relation to that is saying that none, that they all handed over the service charge to the employees, on top of their wages. Well, I can tell you, that's not my experience. Mm. So I would seriously challenge that. And now
Adrian, it's Richard saying that on a legal point of view, an employment law expert, that so many people have come to him and saying that the restaurants are doing this. So what do you say to that?
Well, I haven't seen, show me the cases, point out the exact restaurants that are doing this. You know, I haven't seen the evidence that, you know, the registrar said restaurant A or restaurant B or restaurant C.
But what would the association do to a restaurant if they were doing that, Adrian?
We're not a regulatory body. You have a regulatory body, which is the Workplace Relations Commission, where if there is an issue around employment law, that's where an employee should take their grievance to. Like, we're not a regulatory authority. We haven't got the powers to do that. We're a representative body for restaurant owners. So, you know, there is a process there within the state that if there is a grievance and an employee has, you know, an issue, they can take it to the Workplace Relations Commission. And I think that's the right and proper place to bring it to.
But you are saying it's a good day for restaurants and it's a good day for workers in restaurants across the country.
It's a good day for hospitality in general across our state. I think if memory serves me correctly, we're the first country in Europe, if not the world, that we brought in a piece of legislation like this. I stand corrected, but I think the
Richard
UK
is shaking his head.
Yeah, Richard, are we?
No, we're not. If you go to France, there's a service charge there, and that service charge always went to the staff, and it's been there for years and years and years. Mm. When you were doing it, they had service complete, or they had that there was a gratuity there, the gratuity always went. And if they said the service was complete, that meant that there was a portion of it was going to the staff on top of their wages. Mm. So that was there. So we're not the first in the world. We're the first to regulate what has been a mis-selling to members of the public. So this actually is a good day for members of the public because they're now going to find out what the actual cost of going in is rather than something being added on at the end looking like it's something else.
Well, Richard, as we said, myself and Grainne, and I'm sure so many people looking this morning thought that service charge was going to the staff. We now know it's not, and that's a good day because now we all are a bit clearer on this. Richard and Adrian, thank you so much for joining us this morning. Thanks a lot.
What I want to know is, will the price of food go up now? Well, because that whatever percentage is gone. We'll see. Coming up next, we're talking about the issue of consent in schools. We'll see after this.
Coming up now, a new curriculum on consent and abusive relationships that will help to end violence against women will be rolled out as close to 2024 in primary schools.
Here to discuss if consent should be taught in primary schools is Dr. Siobhan O'Higgins from Active Consent NUIG and Noeline Blackwell from the Dublin Rape Crisis Centre. You're very welcome, both of you. Siobhan, I'm going to come to you first. Is this long overdue, the concept of teaching consent to young children and to get that into their minds from an early age?
Well, I think it's something that parents do anyway. It's part of the education, how we educate our children to actually respect other people and to know their own boundaries in all sorts of things. It's not just about sexual consent. Mm. Children are very aware of consent, you know, how they get a toy off another person without just robbing it or hitting the other person, you know. So we do teach our children this from a very early age anyway, and the thing is now...
But we mustn't be doing a very good job if you look at the amount of assaults on women in particular, and the lack of respect that you do see towards women and the dignity of their bodies nowadays. That teaching from the parents mightn't be getting through all that well.
No, we need to support parents and have education in schools that is up to date, relevant and useful to young people, because young people have been saying for a long time that the RSE or the relationships and sexuality education that they do receive and has been mandatory in this country since the late 1990s, from fifth class upwards in primary school and all the way through secondary school, is not meeting their needs and giving the information that they need. So they're looking for information from other sources. And the problem is those other sources are not teaching them respect. They're not teaching them about boundaries. They're not teaching them how to form mutually respectful, mutually consensual and mutually enjoyable and safe intimate relationships with other people once they're old enough. So there's a lot of confusion for children at the moment. There's all sorts of issues around gender identity. There's so much information out there, and you know, who's giving them the phones? The parents are. So you know, it's about supporting parents to be able to talk to their children as well as the school. You know, it's a double thing to support.
Yeah, we'll definitely come back to that again in a second, Siobhan, but I have to ask Noeline about this. Of course, you work for the Dublin Rape Crisis Centre. I mean, do you think that teaching young children consent, even at primary school level, is this? I mean, have you seen a huge spike in cases in violence against women? We've obviously seen that. Does it go back to young ages to teach this sort of respect?
So I think it is really important that this is done. We know now, for instance, that young people are curious; they're getting information in primary schools. They're watching. Some of them are watching pornography from the age of eight. An awful lot of young children, including young boys, have seen their first pornography between 8 and 11. They're still in primary school. And I think what Siobhan is saying there is so right. You can build up an understanding of what children need to know when they need to know it. Respect for themselves, for their own bodies. Respect for other people and their bodies as well. And just an understanding, giving them language, giving them a way of explaining what they might need to say, because we, as adults, a lot of people come to us about abuse they suffered as children. So even to limit that would be great. So and what we know for sure, we did in the Dublin Rape Crisis Centre, we did research on consent last year, and we know that people, particularly in Ireland, aren't getting the information that they need at a suitable time. They are not comfortable with an understanding of respect, of healthy relationships. You know, I was at a something yesterday in Maynooth where the presenter was saying that, like, his child gets the last class of the school year was, you know, when he got 1 hour in relation to the RSE program for the whole year. So you have a whole you have a whole group of young people growing up without the tools they need, without the language they need, without the understanding. And therefore, when you say, have we a spike in relation to cases? No, but we have more of an understanding now from people that that the abuse that they suffered is not something that they brought on themselves, that someone did it to them, and that where they are engaged, and many, many young people, including young adults, are telling us that they now understand things that they were uncomfortable with or just downright wrong, but they don't have a way. It has to be built into the way we can talk about things.
Siobhan, Noeline was talking there about children being exposed to shocking footage, really, at a very, very young age. And on, at the other side, parents are worried about teaching something like this in schools. You know, surely we have to balance what they're being exposed to now, because you can get anything online, with, as Noeline said, the tools to be able to talk about it, process it, and still... And it doesn't have to do with sex when you're young. It's to do with just respecting another person.
Yeah, and it's not just porn, it's in all sexual media and TikTok, in all the things that they're watching. There's lots of sexual imagery and sexual ideas that they're picking up, you know. And absolutely, we need to give them critical media literacy skills, which is just added to the other things that they have to learn. But there are wonderful programs happening in Ireland at the moment. We've got Webwise and CyberSafe Kids do very good programs for primary school children in relation to understanding the disinhibition effect that you get, because people aren't being kind to each other on the internet. And you know, it's part of that. It's, as Noeline says, it's about building an understanding of how to form respectful and kind relationships with other people, not just intimate relationships, but kind relationships. And you know, we're giving them the phones, so just understand that. And it's about supporting parents as well as the school to be able to talk to their children, because I mean, how the context in which they're exploring their sexuality is very different from when we were growing up. Absolutely. You know, the context has changed so much, so we need to not be judgmental, not judging it from our own viewpoint, but actually to listen to our children.
Is this about consent with sex with primary school children? I mean, we talked about porn, but is this what you're going to be doing, or is it just consent in a wider basis?
But it's consent not just about sex. It's about, you know, coming into someone's personal space to understand that you have a personal space and you allow people that you trust, your friends and your family, into your personal space. But you don't let anybody come into your personal space, and you don't go into other people's personal space. And it's that kind of lesson of respect and knowing, because consent is, you know, students on our program came up with the idea that consent is OMFG, ongoing, mutual and freely given. So understanding that it's an ongoing thing. Just because, you know, you touch someone or you held someone's hand before, you can't assume that they want to do it again. But also it's being able to deal with rejection, all those things, because we're not teaching our children those kind of skills, you know.
I can see that with my own five-year-old. There are a lot of parents out there with a lot of children just don't understand the word no. And of course, from a young age, you're taught you can have whatever you want, you can do whatever you want, and that's something that needs to change. Listen, Dr. Siobhan Higgins, thank you so much for joining us again this morning, and Noeline Blackwell, of course, from the Dublin Rape Crisis Centre. Thank you so much for joining us. I mean, it'd be really interested to get your opinion on that as well at home, 0896 111 111. And if you want to get more information on this, check out the consenthub.ie.
Very interesting. Alan, what's on the way over the next 2 hours?
Well, Grainne, still to come this morning, we're having cookies in the kitchen with Joe Shannon, and I'll be taking you on a sun-soaked getaway to Gozo. Stay with us for that.
So it's time now to look at the morning's papers, starting with the Irish Times. Its headline reads, pressure mounts for an early budget in September. The budget could be brought forward by a month by the government as it faces significant pressure from the opposition about the cost of living crisis.
Sophie, cold case, new witnesses key to probe. That's the front page of the Irish Independent. Improvements to DNA testing and new witness statements have prompted Gardaí to launch a cold case review into the murder of Sophie Toscan de Plantier. Now, we are having a bit of a problem bringing up the graphics there, so instead of us holding up the papers, we'll talk about texts. And thankfully, Alan's here. What have we got?
Yeah, there's so many texts coming in, and we were talking to Adrian Cummins about this new... the service charge.
I can't believe this. I always thought whenever you see service charge at the bottom, that's 12%, going, whatever it is.
It went to the... Yeah. We all thought that.
Mm. And it doesn't go to the staff.
According to, like, Richard this morning and Adrian, it never went. It was never meant to go to it, which is crazy. So that went to restaurants. I always thought that was it. Emer in County Clare says, good morning. When I go to a restaurant, I always refuse to pay the service charge. Well, are you allowed to do that? Which you're well entitled to do, Emer says. When this is removed from the bill, I leave a tip for the server. When I leave a tip, I always ask the server if they'll actually get it. I had an incident in Dublin where I refused to pay the service charge, which wasn't a huge deal. But when I asked the server, who was brilliant, if they got the tip, he said, we get our food instead.
Yeah.
That's standard in restaurants. Yeah. I left him a tip. I left a tip and was told by the manager that had to go into the till.
But so the food would be only one tip. Do you mean if you think you get a 10 or 15, 20 quid
and
tip,
you're just there for
the food? Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I mean, a good waiter, waitress, whatever else, will be worth a fortune.
Emer says never pay a service charge. Now, so can you actually refuse by law to
take it off?
So then they have to go and take it off the bill.
Yeah. You sort of say the service wasn't good here, or I don't agree with a service charge, take it off the bill. Mm.
Or just give cash.
Restaurants are going to love us this morning.
Yeah. Oh, well, let us know what you do with that 0896 111 111.
And if you are a restaurant, be honest with us, let us know, do you need that service charge to keep the doors open?
Yeah. And if it's now going to be declared, are we going to see the prices on food going up?
Also, we were talking about consent as well, quickly, and just talking about bringing it into the curriculum in primary schools as well as secondary schools. We've messed in here. Let's call a spade a spade. Many parents failing to do their job again can be taught in school, but children need to live this kindness, respect at home. Children learn what they live, and teachers can only do so much. Absolutely. School is 9 to 3/4. Parents need to take responsibility, and I think that is, people ask an awful lot of the teachers and schools. Yeah. You have to teach this stuff at a young age at home as well. So 0896 111 111. Please do get in touch on anything we're chatting about. We'd love to hear from you. Now, I might get interested in this as well. Coming up, regularly we hear the saying, go vegan to help save the planet. But is that really the truth? Coming up next, author of The Great Plant-Based Con joins us for a chat. Chat to you soon.
Welcome back. Now, are we being misled by claims that plant-based diets are better for us and for the environment?
In her book, The Great Plant-Based Con, author Jayne Buxton asks, if the environmental arguments for veganism are based on false and misleading statistics. And Jayne joins us now. Good morning to you, Jayne. Thank you so much for talking to us this morning, because it is something that we hear all the time now, is save the planet, go vegan, healthier diet, potentially live longer, go vegan. For you to write a book like this, because I'm sure you're expecting a huge backlash from it, you know, what's your background in this and what made you get into this, I suppose, this topic that can be seen as maybe a bit divisive?
Yeah. Well, thank you for having me. It's great to be here. My background is in as an author. I've written fiction and nonfiction, and so the idea of research is not new to me. And I've done research both in a journalistic capacity, an authorial capacity, and previously in my work in as a management consultant. And really, that's how I started on this whole enterprise. Because around 2019, I started to notice that the plant-based messaging was getting ever stronger. It was really ubiquitous. It was a singular message. And I also noticed that some of the facts which were being used to support that message were not facts as I understood them. And so I began the research. And the deeper I dug, the more I went into it, the more I realized that the extent of the misinformation was really extensive, and I felt a book needed to be written.
So it's another marketing ploy. Is that what you're saying?
Well, it's not. I don't think it's quite that simple. I mean, that's one element of it, which is that a big business, big food, certainly has an interest in pushing this message, because the vegan movement has opened up an entirely new market for them in terms of vegan processed foods. But they're not the only ones. I think that feeds into a kind of constellation of groups who have an interest in pushing this message. And that includes, you know, the media, who love the headlines on which are based on some of these studies, which, by the way, the studies that say you're going to live longer if you're a vegan, if you dig deep into those studies, they very rarely actually tell you that. That's not the conclusion. So we all need to be alert to that kind of messaging.
So that is a form of misinformation. But what do you mean now with misinformation that we're hearing from this vegan constant message in the media?
Well, you know, the message that you talked about, which was the best thing you can do to help the planet is to go vegan. So this is a message we see every day in the newspapers, on the news, whatever. Now, contrast that with something that Professor Miles Allen, he's a UK scientist at the University of Oxford, who served on the IPCC's committee on 1.5 degrees. He has stated categorically that if we eliminate the methane from livestock, this will have a very, very minor effect on global warming.
Minor effect.
We're told that this will be a game changer if we stop eating beef.
Minor effect. Those are his words. And he said if we do not address the sources of fossil fuel warming, pretty much nothing else is relevant. Now, that to me is a categoric statement. Even the IPCC has acknowledged in their recent paper that the methane impact has been overstated because of the metrics that are being used. It's been overstated by 3 to 4 times. So we need to put the discussion into that context.
So how do you get the message out there? Or are you finding that people don't want to hear it, that they've taken on this? It feeds almost like a cult sometimes, this idea that we should be getting all our nutrients from plant-based diet, and that if you like your meat and if you're into that you're not only old-fashioned, but you're unhealthy and that you don't care about the environment.
Yeah. So you're right. There are two, I think, groups of people. There are those people who do not want to hear the message at all. And there are those people who are heartily relieved that somebody is saying this. Mm. And I've had massive amount of support from those people who've said, you know, I suspected this all along. And now you're giving me the data to talk about this. And the data that I'm using is, you know, sometimes it's both the environmental data, but also looking at the nutrient reality in foods and what plant-only diets do provide, what they don't provide. Giving people some real information so that even if they do choose not to eat meat, they do it with their eyes open rather than closed.
It's really interesting from the book as well. You talk about getting in your five a day, and that's something we hear as a child. Get in your five fruit and vegetables, so important. But that actually started from a marketing ploy, is that right?
A marketing campaign, yes. And there is no evidence that five a day is the magic number or that everybody benefits from five a day. What I would really prefer to see is a message which says, eat a wide variety of real foods that are nutrient dense. And that will include fruits and vegetables, but it will also include really nutrient dense animal source foods.
What about, you know, meat substitutes that, you know, that have been on the shelf for a long time, these fake meats? When you get into processing food, I mean, isn't the nutritional value of that food diminished by the amount of processing that it goes through? And that stands to reason.
Certainly, the processing does diminish the nutrients, that's for sure. But there are other issues with those foods, which is the ingredients which they're made with are nutrient poor to start with. They don't have the same level of the same nutrient profile, and that's been proven in a study by Duke University recently. It's also been proven they don't deliver the same amount of protein or the same quality of protein, and this is why we're seeing in America there's a lawsuit against one of the big plant-based meat companies because they've been overstating the protein content of their product.
So for supplements wise, does it not, because people say, well, we'll just take supplements. But is it right that they just don't digest the same as if you'd had it from a natural, from a steak, for instance?
That is correct, that the when you take supplements outside of a food environment, a proper food, a real food, it doesn't interact with the body in the same way. It's not absorbed in the same way. And in some cases, nutrients that are taken in a supplement form can be actually dangerous. Calcium is one of those if you take it outside of a food form. But then you also have to look at the basic question, which is, what is food for? Food is to nourish us, to help us to survive and thrive. So I really question a diet or a dietary approach which says, oh, well, that doesn't matter, we'll just take the pills. That really seems to deny the purpose of food.
Jayne, do you think this train has left the station? And when you get to the fact that there's a vegan menu in McDonald's, that bastion of meat and everything that goes with it, when you get to that stage, when they've adapted and they've taken it on board, do you think that this train has left the station, that, you know, no matter what kind of information you put in front of people now, that it's not going to get through?
I have to think not. I have to be positive and hopeful, because I think that our future health and the health of our planet depends upon us overturning this singular narrative. So those vegan menus, those restaurants are just doing what they need to do, which is adapt to a market. And it is about marketing and surviving. So, you know, you can't blame them. That's what they're doing. But I think that there is a slight shift now, and my book is falling into that open space where people are willing to talk about the realities of nutrition, and also those realities I was alluding to do with the environment, where we need to accept that giving up meat to save the environment is a little bit like a deck chair rearranging exercise, right? It's not going to move the needle. And we can virtue signal all we want by choosing those vegan options and giving up the meat. But that's really only stopping us from doing what we really need to do, which is address fossil fuel-based emissions, which dominate our economies.
Yeah, certainly really is interesting, this. Jayne Buxton, of course, your book is called The Great Plant-Based Con. Fascinating to chat with you, Jayne, and certainly is something that we're hearing so much about at the minute. And I think that that's really opened up a lot of eyes and... yeah, I'm sure a lot of people would be really interested to read your book. Thank you so much for joining us this morning.
Thank you.
Now, I'm relieved. I'm going to have a steak and no conscience about it, no guilt at all.
But all the way through training, and we've had dietitians and nutritionists and doctors, and they've always talked about a square diet. And if you have a good, healthy diet with a bit of everything in it, you can't go wrong. Absolutely. So anyway, listen, all this food is certainly working up my attitude. I'm hoping there's going to be a burger in the kitchen. What do you reckon, Al?
I don't think so. Are white shortbread cookies allowed?
Jane would be too happy with that.
Is that on the list?
Everything in moderation.
Because, Joe Shannon, that's exactly what we're making. Stick around after the break. We're going straight to the dessert. And Joe Shannon is making his white chocolate cookie. See you after this.
Inspired by nature. Powered by light. Beko Harvest Fresh sponsors cookery on Ireland AM.
I thought you were going to pour for yourself first.
I'll be mother.
Good morning. Welcome back. It's Sweet Treat in the kitchen. Joe Shannon's got a sword. Look at these chocolate bickies and tea.
We're having tea and biscuits.
For two. And two for tea.
Do you take milk?
Tea for two. And two for tea.
You just carry on.
And entertainment as well.
Entertainment, yeah.
So I have a lovely, beautiful shortbread. And shortbread, of course, originally comes from Scotland, apparently from the 12th century.
Does it?
Yeah, because apparently Scotland and the French had a special relationship during the 12th century. And they reckon that the French chefs and the Scottish became very friendly. And they came up with this creation of shortbreads, otherwise known as shorties. And was developed, as we know it now, in the 16th century. It's been very popular ever since then, believe it or not. What it is I have for the recipe 200 grams of butter, 100 grams of sugar. A lot of sugar.
200 grams of butter and 100 grams of sugar.
Extra taste in that. Perfect.
Now, from a cost point of view, you can get different grades of butter that you can buy. What I mean? Cheaper to dear. I'm just conscious of the times we're living in.
But would you know the difference?
To be honest with you, because... Where Irish butter is brilliant is because our cattle feed of grass, which makes the milk richer. But also, when they make butter in Ireland, they churn it for longer. Makes it extra more flavoursome, you know?
But can you buy very fancy butter?
Oh, you can, absolutely.
There's some massive Irish brands out there. You can't beat a Kerrygold or something like that.
Yeah, fantastic. Any Irish butter is good. And there's some artisan butters out there that are fantastic.
There we go, darling.
So into our butter, I've creamed that for about 10 minutes before we came on air. And I'm adding some orange zest, 50 grams of corn flour, 100 grams of ground almonds, and I'm adding 200 grams of plain flour. All right? Now...
Almonds always go into shortbread?
No, this is for this particular recipe. If you don't want, and almonds can be quite expensive, if you want to make it a little bit cheaper, leave the almonds out and substitute it for flour. Okay. So that'd be an extra 100 grams of flour into the mix.
Okay.
What we do then is you mix that around, and one thing you need to remember is, the mix will be, it's not going to be like a pastry where it's going to be all sort of formed into a dough, for the want of a better word. And the one thing you have to also remember, the less handling of it, the better. Because the heat of your hands will upset the texture of the butter. It will heat the butter and melt the butter.
Looks like it's hard. A bit of elbow grease has to go into
actually. You leave it like this. And basically, it will still be sort of, look sort of very crumbly, for the want of a better word.
Okay.
And what you would do then is just leave it wrap it in some cling film or parchment paper and leave it in the fridge for about 15 minutes to half an hour. All right.
Okay.
What happens then is you take it out the fridge and it is firmed up.
What's the difference between that and cookie dough? No, sorry.
Cookies, it's a different. There's less butter in a cookie dough, know what I mean?
Okay.
It's just a different texture to what it.
Because you get cookie dough comes like that as well, don't you?
You do, wrap it up. Absolutely.
Yeah. Okay.
And what you do when you take it out of your fridge, you just form it together with your hands, just as simple as that, and there's no need to knead it. Okay. All right. What you do then is you roll it out, as I have one ready here already, okay? And roll it to, depending on what sort of thickness you want it. I would suggest for cookies about 3 millimetres. is enough, up to yourself. And then if you have a little cutter, you basically just cut them out, very simply, just like so, onto some parchment paper.
How many would you get from that recipe?
From that recipe there, you're going to get roughly, depending on the size of the ring you're using,
oh, yeah,
but you're going to get roughly about maybe 12 to 20 rings, depending on the size of your ring. Okay. All right. So that very simply then goes into an oven for 16 minutes. And before you put it in, before you put it in, just give it a little prick with your with your fork. And into our lovely Beko oven for 16 minutes. Now behave yourselves, will you? Right?
Oh, keep going, Joe.
Are you all right there? Are you?
So,
can I go
anyway,
on?
So can I go put them on a wire so tray then.
What you have then after 16 minutes is you have your cookie, let them cool on a wire tray, all right, when they're fully cold. Oh. What we want to do is we want to stuff them, don't we? All right, so... So what we're going to use for our stuffing is a little bit of raspberry jam and some white chocolate, grated white chocolate, and give it a little mix, OK? And then what we do is quite simply sandwich them together, put a little piece there, sandwich them together, and then we dip them. We give them a little dipping in some white chocolate. You're all right, no problem. Give them a little dipping, like so. Right? We let that harden. All right? Let that harden, right? And then we give it a little drizzle, right? A little drizzle then of chocolate. There's nothing like
this
a drizzle.
This is innuendo bingo today. This is show
for like so. And you can just have them plain just like that if you want as well.
Ah, no, they look good. That was fun.
And a little dusting of icing sugar.
Ah, very nice.
Just to finish them off. And we end up with what's in front of
you. Oh, they are delicious. They're delicious. Thank you, Joe.
And that's our comedy cookies. Oh,
join us next week.
For the second part of the comedy piece that we're doing here.
Oh, I've devoured two of them already. They're absolutely gorgeous.
You like them, yeah?
Absolutely delicious. They're
I'm going to say nothing because I know I'm going to get myself into trouble.
You're going to be in trouble, all right.
Joe Shannon, thank you so much for that. They are delicious. We've all had loads already.
Thank you for the lovely laugh.
That was a great laugh. Here. Thanks, Joe.
No problem.
Right, now has Derek got the power? He's had that poor woman doing deadlifts all morning. So he's going to be challenging a world champion power lifter after the break. You don't want to miss it.
Inspired by nature. Powered by light. Beko Harvest Fresh sponsors cookery on Ireland AM.
Oh, that was a loud laugh. Look at this baby cup of tea. I know. It's gorgeous. Now, time to get back over to Nafina Gaelic Football Club in Glasnevin.
Derek, what are you up to? As if we have to ask, driving those poor ladies.
He's in the Gladiators.
All about here this morning. I'm telling you, these are some group of women. Rihanna joins us now. Rihanna, talk us through the sport of powerlifting.
Powerlifting, people get confused. It's actually not like Olympic lifting. It's just three lifts, which is the squat, bench, and deadlift.
Okay, and a lot of people would associate it as a male-dominated sport.
Yes, definitely, back in the old day, but now, you know, in 2022, there's way more women, as you can see here, loving the powerlifting, seeing the benefits from it, their body shaping up, losing weight, bone density, especially most of my women are over 40.
And that's what we were talking about earlier on, because I think when a lot of women, you know, go weightlifting, or think about even weightlifting, they think that they're gonna get really bulky, really muscly. That's not the case.
That myth is gone. So. But women now understand that cardio is not the way to get weight loss or for to look good. Now, I'm quite bulky, but I'm a powerlifter. I lift very heavy. The women who take them years to get to my size. So they're understanding their clothes are fitting better, they're losing weight in their waist, their shape is changing, getting a little bit bigger shoulders, makes their waist look smaller. They're loving it.
And I'd be looking at the girls here now this morning, the glutes, the bum,
yeah,
the top,
the squats. The ladies love the squats. All about the booty.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, you are a powerlifting champion. How many times?
18 world records I hold.
18.
Yes.
Records. Phenomenal. And the aim is?
To get 20, obviously, and then we'll see what happens then. So my biggest squat is 240 kilos, weighing in a 66 kilo body weight.
And of course, your trainer, down in Limerick.
Yes, as you're from Limerick, you're familiar with my Jerry McNamara, all-time world champion. and my coach for the last 6 years, where I commute to Limerick once a week to train with him, and he's awesome.
And he cracks the whip with you now.
Oh, he does.
This is a partnership with Dublin City Council.
It is indeed. So I work for Dublin City Council, started off with Paul Donnelly, doing one class a week in Poppentry Community Centre, and now I work with John MacDonald. I have 12 classes going in the north side for the women. Basically, thanks to Caroline Connery, our new Lord Mayor, introduced me to everyone in Dublin City Council.
So you're like Dublin City's answer to Xena Warrior Prince.
Absolutely.
Isn't you, girl?
These are my queens, yes.
Sandra, put the weight down, put the plate down, come over to me, give me your squeeze. When did you, or why did you decide to get into powerlifting?
7 years ago, I decided to get into powerlifting because my muscle tone wasn't so good.
Okay.
As you get older, you lose muscle tone. Mm. So I wanted to give myself more muscle, and that's why I went
in. And are you glad you got into it?
I love it. I love Rihanna's classes. I love all the ladies. We have fun, and that's the main thing.
And that's the main thing about it, yeah. And great camaraderie. And that's what I was saying to Christine earlier on this morning. Christine, you joined the group because of all the other girls.
Absolutely, yeah, to make friends, have a good time, and I really enjoy it.
And I hear you like to go out to the weekends as well.
Of course.
To have a few scoops or to lift in the weights.
Yeah, absolutely.
But it's great. And are you finding it helps you?
Oh, absolutely, yeah.
Yeah, and I have to say, you're looking smashing here this morning as well.
I mean, we do go in for competitions as well, so... It's good fun.
Okay, yeah. Okay. And you're really enjoying it.
Yeah, love it.
And really enjoy it. Yeah. Now, we're going to pop over here. Finally, we're going to say hello to Colette. Now, Colette, what I love about you is not only are you a mammy, not only are you a granny, but you're also a...
Great-granny.
A great-granny. Give her a big round of applause. Come on, girls. Oh, you're a great-granny.
I am.
And why did you decide to get into powerlifting?
Well, it's for mental health and to meet new friends.
Okay. And in terms of your class, then, how often do you train, Colette?
I go twice a week.
Okay.
Just Tuesday and Thursday.
And how do you feel when you leave the class? Do you feel it's good for you?
Yes, it's brilliant.
And I'd say they're all looking at you now at home, all your grandchildren, all your great-grandchildren, and they're like, she is super great-grand.
I hope.
And as I said to Sandra there, lots of camaraderie and great fun between the girls as well.
Yeah.
Okay, and you enjoy it?
Yeah.
Would you recommend it?
Oh, God, yes. Yes,
okay.
Yes, it's brilliant. Yeah.
Get out there.
I'm not doing that then, I run as well.
You run as well, so lift plates, lift weights.
Yeah.
Okay, right, so we're going to finish off here with a demo now. Remember, this is the 18-time world champion, right? So we've got here, what have we got here, Rihanna?
It's only 100 kilos of warm-up in the bar, Derek.
You know? Oh, God, 100 kilos. So are you going to demo? You're going to demo, show us how it's done properly.
So
okay.
Most ways conventional for a deadlift. So see the markings on the bar.
Okay.
And feet shoulder width apart, toes facing slightly out. See the markings here. You don't want one hand over here, one hand here. So you want two hands on same on each side.
Okay.
Mix grip so you can lift more.
Okay.
Don't go overhand if you can. So find out which one is comfortable.
So overhand, underhand?
Yeah. So you're pulling with your hamstrings, your glutes, your lower back.
Okay.
You're only holding the bar. You're not doing this or anything like that.
Okay.
Which a lot of people do. So you're going to sit back. Put your hips down and put your chest up.
Oh,
and
God.
Pull.
She makes that look
That's
like a piece of cake. Oh, God.
Warm up.
Come on, give her a round of applause.
You want to give that a go, Derek?
So I'm going to get in here, right? So this is
walk right into the bar,
So we're overhand grip, underhand.
Put hands in closer.
Yeah, nice and tight.
Hips down, chest up.
Okay, here we go.
Head,
100 kg.
And pull it up, rip it up. Come on, make it look easy.
That's where you find her on her socials. And Tommy, 18 times world champion!
Yeah.
On to the studio.
Thanks.
Oh,
so impressive.
Well done, Derek.
Well done.
Well done, Ran. And tell you what, she did about 20 of those. He was struggling to do three.
She's very good, isn't
yeah,
she?
Yeah, very impressive. Yeah, absolutely.
Wow. Excellent.
Some noise to you with your ears to be fairly nice in there this morning.
They're all hyper down there this
thanks
morning.
Thanks very much for that, Derek. That was a bit of crack.
Time now for a break, but coming up at the final hour of Ireland AM, we're in shed storage heaven. Yes, it exists. As we get a lesson in decluttering your small spaces.
Plus, we're going to go movie mad with all the latest cinema releases. Stay with us. We're back after this short break.
Now, part two of my adventures on the stunning island of Malta is coming up next.
And you could be in with a chance of winning your own getaway to Malta. Somebody will win this morning.
Yeah.
Flights, courtesy of Shannon Airport, and 4 nights bed and breakfast in the 5-star Malta Marriott Hotel and Spa. To enter, little bit of time left. We want to hear your funniest sun holiday stories.
Yeah, we haven't picked a winner yet, so if you want to get a really quick story in, do send it in to irelandm@virginmedia.ie and you can check out the T's and C's on the Virgin Media Television website.
Yeah, we'll call the winner live on air at the end of the show, so good luck. You have till about 9:30 this morning to do that. But yeah, up next, my next installment as I visit Malta's sister island, Gozo. We'll see you after the break. Thanks for staying with us. Now it's time to take a look at part two of my recent trip to Malta.
Action.
God, yous Maltese know how to party, Vince. What time did we actually get home at? Welcome to our Maltese adventure. After a night, we certainly did not hit the town. It's day two. There's so much more to the Maltese islands than just Malta. And today we're catching a ferry to its sister island, Gozo. Is everybody back up in the building? It's been a minute, tell me how you're feeling. And a short ferry ride will have you at the island in less than 30 minutes. Right now. First up, it was time to brave the rugged terrain to get to the beautiful Mishta Caves. Well, this is as far as I can go in my e-jeep. It's time to get a little more adventurous. I ain't worried about it. Well, we finally arrived at the Mishta Caves, one of Gozo's top tourist attractions. And look, with views like this, you can see why. Well, do you know what? All this cave exploring is hungry work. I think it's time for some lunch. Take my breath away, like I know you want to. Now, if you're in Gozo and you fancy a picnic outdoors, I've got you sorted. I'm on my way to meet Anna Kiesling from Gozo Picnics to tell us more. Anna, this looks beautiful. Thank you for inviting us. Tell us where the idea of Gozo Picnics came from.
Thank you very much, and it's a pleasure to have you here.
Oh, thank you.
The idea came from me becoming a mom. I wanted the best for my daughter, so I always carried a little parcel with some food for her.
All right.
And then we wandered, being outdoors, being on the beach, being in the fields among the animals, which is best for the kids. I always had a basket with food, and one day we were sitting, enjoying it, and I was like, why don't I do it for others?
And so it grew from that.
And it grew from that. And I celebrated 4 years of Gozo Picnic this year.
And Tommy, you're from Ukraine.
I am, yes.
How long have you been in Gozo?
It's been 14 years.
And so people, when they come to Gozo, they can contact you and you can go bring this beautiful display everywhere. And I see the beautiful sunflowers representing, because I know they're very associated with Ukraine.
Yes.
So tell me about the foods that we have here today. What type of food do you normally display?
So I have three different menus for people to choose, which is vegan, gluten-free and Mediterranean.
So we'll be doing Mediterranean today.
Yes,
so
yes,
we have a lovely pasta here.
We have a pasta with multi sausage.
And then we have some salads.
Cherry tomatoes, which are seasonal at the moment. We have green lentils and local beetroot.
So I think it's time to tuck in.
Yes.
Shall we start?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay, let's do it. While we were in Gozo, we heard there was a honey festival on in one of the local parks, so we decided to drop along and have a look. Ready, young, my granny got no time for playing games. So Maria, tell us, what's so special about the honey from Gozo?
Okay, so when it comes to Gozo honey, we're producing very, very good
Godison and Maltese honey. Due to the climate that we have, our bees adapted to our climate, okay, since we have around 300 days of sunshine yes. over here. We have summer honey, we have spring honey.
So does that mean all your honeys will have little different tangs to them and different tastes?
Yes, yeah? Yes. Yeah. It really depends where the bees are going to eat from.
Yes. And tell me, what do we have here then? We're going to taste some of this. So what's this?
Ooh, that's our multiflora honey.
Multiflora, okay. So does yes. that mean it's like... The bees were eating from lots of different
yes,
things.
Yes, exactly. Different flowers, different flora, actually. Yeah. Does
delicious.
It taste good?
Yeah, it delicious. Good. Really it nice. Line me up.
Okay.
Get the jars
Let's
in.
Go. Let's
Here
go.
We go. Come on. Bringing all this back to Ireland.
Kilos. You're such a sweet
talker. You made me buddy. What's this? A wetsuit? Yeah. Nobody told me about a wetsuit. What's going on? Why do I need a wetsuit? I thought we were coming here for ice cream. I'm here in the Crystal Lagoon, nestled between Gozo and Malta, and it attracts thousands of visitors every year. Well, during my trip, I've segued, I've sailed, and today I'm supporting. Well, that was a complete disaster, but you know what? I've had a great time here in Gozo and Malta. So much to see and do, and I can't wait to come back again. But for now... You're such a sweet talker, man of my dreams.
Tell me, where are you now? Wow.
Absolutely gorgeous. And so much fun. You're great fun.
So we had so much fun for the 2 days. It really is. Malta and Gozo, they're just brilliant places to go.
Stunning.
They really are.
200 days of sunshine. I mean, when you see the weather outside, oh, it makes you sick, doesn't it?
Yeah, like, just,
it's
that's
gorgeous.
The thing, just to get there. When we were there, it was 35 degrees every day.
Mm.
And
wow.
Just beautiful, lovely. And there's so much to do
yeah.
on both islands.
Yeah.
And we saw yesterday, like, when you're visiting Valletta, the silent city in Malta, there's just so much you don't... Like, if you want to lie on the beach, you can do that, or you're sunbed by your pool all day, but then there's so much else to explore, so
oh.
it's great. And we were asking for funny stories because...
Yes.
You
someone,
could win a chance
yes,
to go.
Someone is going to go to Malta today by the end of the show today. But I love this. We were asking for your funny stories because we know there's chaos at airports and we didn't want any of those horror stories.
Go on,
and I love this. One. Paul from Wexford. My mum and myself were on holidays in the Costa del Sol and my mum took her false teeth out to eat, wrapped them up in a napkin. Now, a few wines later, we moved from the restaurant to the bar and my mum turned around to me and started talking. I said, Mum, where's your teeth? So we ran back to the restaurant, the whole restaurant and staff looking for the teeth. We eventually found them in a bin.
Awesome.
Wrapped in the napkin. We thankfully look back now and laugh about it. But she got her teeth back.
Thank God.
Imagine taking
Mom,
your teeth.
Where's your teeth?
Mom, where's your teeth?
Tracy got in touch and said, myself and my partner went away to Lanzarote when the Ironman Marathon was on there 3 years ago. Anyway, we're on the beach and we decided to go for a swim. I was wearing one of those bikinis that tied at both sides and Mark, my partner, picked me up and threw me into the water. And as he did so, the ties on both sides opened. My bottoms were washed away. Of course, the Ironman, so crowded. I had to walk past about 1,000 spectators to get a towel to cover myself, and all my partner could do was laugh.
I was going to
laugh.
Say, where's the
partner? Oh, yeah, laughing. Laughing.
So she's just... like this and going along like this.
Exactly. Exactly. So the next day we were back on the beach and when getting changed into dry clothes, I took all his clothes and towel and I ran just so he'd have an idea of what it felt like for
nice.
Me.
Love it.
Good
love
woman.
It. Love it.
Revenge.
We have one from Louise here as well. Myself and my husband were on a honeymoon in the Maldives, booked in for a lovely couple's massage. So relaxing. When it was over, we were brought to the shower area where they left us shower caps for us. My husband went to hand one to me and I said, no thanks, you know, I'm going to wash my hair before we head back to the room. We didn't realise there was another part to the couple's massage and we were brought out to this beautiful veranda looking out over the sea with a jacuzzi and champagne. Few people out there in the sea with their canoes.
Then the girls came over and whipped the towels off. Both of us were standing there, both stark naked in front of everyone. The girls didn't know where to look. We jumped into the jacuzzi. My husband ended up in the shallow part of the jacuzzi. So they weren't shower caps. They were disposable pants
that you had to
put them on under the towels. So they were standing there in the nude. We laughed so much, something we'll never forget. There's one from the Maldives you remember.
Isn't it great that you have these memories? I love this one from Dolores. After a lovely meal and fab wine in Mallorca, we walked out of the restaurant with my husband. The sun was shining. I linked his arm and we were walking down and I said, isn't this wonderful? Isn't life great? We should come here again. And she turned around and it wasn't her husband that she was linking. She just linked some randomer as you're walking along. And she literally said, oh, you're not my husband. She looked behind the husband roaring laughing and the man just walked off without saying a word.
I love it. That's a brilliant story. That's
brilliant. Listen, they're class stories. We are going to pick a winner at the very end of the show, though, so you do
and
have
somebody
time.
Somebody is if going to Malta.
Someone is going to be going to Malta. Beautiful hotel, the whole lot. So, we might have another winner, might have another story as well, so send them in quickly, irelandm@virginmedia.ie. Now, coming up after the break, we're going to be talking all things cinema releases, spine-tingling horrors to animated adventures. There's something there for everyone. See you in a couple of minutes. Welcome back. Now, our resident movie man, Brian Lloyd, is here with his take on the latest flicks.
Brian, you're very welcome. First of all, we're going to take a look at the fifth film, I can't believe it, in the Minions franchise. Have a look.
There are a lot of other villains in the world, but I am going to be a super villain.
This world is mine for the taking. Make me king as we move toward a new world order.
This puny little child thinks he can be a villain.
I am pretty despicable. All right, I'm not Minnie. Please stop calling me that.
Brian, it looks like this is how Gru came to be, his backstory, essentially.
Yeah, I mean, that's it. Like, as you said, like, it's coming into the fifth film now, so, like, really they're running kind of low on ideas, so they're going back to him in the 70s. Yeah, it's him basically trying to join this villain supergroup called the Vicious Six. And, I mean, the interesting thing about this is that the voice cast they've got is pretty great. Like, they have Alan Arkin and they have Taraji P. Henson. Yeah, exactly, Alan Arkin. Like, he's known for doing these, like, really kind of intelligent, dry and witty comedies. Yes. So to see him doing something like this, which is just, like, completely slapstick, like, you saw the fart bomb there and everything. Like, that kind of
love it.
Yeah, I know, fantastic. Yeah, like,
that's it. Like, it's the level we're at here.
But it's for kids, isn't it?
It is for kids. That's the thing. Like, that is the thing. Like, this is very much aimed at kids. Like,
the great thing about the Minions movies is as well, you get all these lovely gems, you know, through that are for adults as well.
Yeah, you do, in fairness. Yeah, like, there are some moments in it I think that are quite sweet and a little bit more kind of, I wouldn't say advanced, but you know, that kind of would probably fly over the head of kids.
Yes.
But yeah, at 88 minutes, this is just all for the kids. Like, it's really, really loud, really, really colourful. I think, you know, it is kind of running out of steam a bit, I think. Like, they really are trying to, I mean, like, going all the way back to the 70s, you know, and trying to, you know, the origin story for Gru seems a little bit thin on the ground and everything. But, I mean, you know, people are going to turn up for it. So, what's the harm?
My kids love it. And all the kind of silly humour, all that sort of stuff. I mean, the Minions, it does exactly what it says in the tin for kids. And that's what you... I mean, how... Like, because we've got four movies to get through. So, I mean, how do you rate it?
I mean three out of five.
Okay.
It's grand. Like, I mean, like, it's 88 minutes. It's not going to kill you to sit and watch it with the kids.
Yeah.
The kids will love it, like, so.
Yeah. So from a kids movie like that to a complete contrast, we're going to a horror movie then, The Black Phone.
Mm. The Black Phone. Oh, yeah, so you were like,
it's got something for everyone.
Can't do it, can't do horrors.
So this is based on a short story by Joe Hill, and if you don't know who Joe Hill is, he's Stephen King's son.
Oh, it's in the genes then.
It's clearly in the genes, and in fact, he's actually in the film as well, in a sort of a cameo. cameo role, and he looks exactly like his dad. So what's going on here is that Ethan Hawke plays this serial killer called the Grabber, and his thing is that he kidnaps children and keeps them in his house.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah, right, pretty dark stuff. Yeah, and then in the actual basement where he keeps them, there's this black phone.
In a basement as well?
Yeah, in a basement.
Oh jeez, right.
Yeah, and this black phone basically is able to communicate with the previous victims. So there's one kid down there, and every time he picks up the phone, he's talking to the dead kids. Yeah, it's pretty dark.
Ah, yeah.
Sign me up for that. Yeah, yeah.
So Ethan Hawke is in it, though.
Yeah, and he doesn't do these villainous roles at all, but he is brilliant in it. Like, he's such a good actor. Like, and
he's
you can tell
Grabber.
That. Yeah, the Grabber. Like, yeah, that's he wears this like horrible mask and everything. Like, you can see him there. Like, he's got this weird kind of look about him. It's a lot. It's quite disturbing, I would say.
So it's a paranormal horror. Is that
paranormal horror, and then it's kind of like a coming of age drama, and then there's a whole sort of subplot about like, you know, where actually is the Grabber and how is he selecting the children and all this kind of stuff. So like, there's a lot going on, but for, you know, for like a film that's like about 100 to 110 minutes, it's trying to cram everything in, and it doesn't really work. It kind of loses its way a little bit. Mm. I would say to Ethan Hawke, he's the best thing about this film. You know, he hasn't done this kind of film
before. Is this
kind
of coming from Stranger Things, that kind of feeling?
Oh, yeah, 100%.
Yeah,
totally. Like, because the fact that, like, Stephen King has had, like, a bit of a resurgence, like, and God knows how many films have been made out of it. So now they're literally going to the Suns kind of stuff to, I guess,
keep mining that.
Yeah, keep mining and keep finding
Did you enjoy it?
Good crack, yeah. I mean, like, if you
it's
like
good crack,
if you like horrors, you'll get something out of it for sure. Like, but yeah, it is a little bit kind of you've seen it done before, I think.
Star wise,
3.5 out of 5.
Oh, okay.
It's good.
I'm expecting that, to be fair.
Yeah, like, I mean, I think if you're in the mood for a horror, it's definitely worth a watch.
Oh, it frightens the life out of me when you have kids and you hear that. Let's move on to Nitram. Mm.
Yeah. So this is a art house psychological drama, and it's based on the 1996 Port Arthur massacre. saying earlier, like, how are you going to get the popcorn out? I'm like, yeah, well, I don't know about that. This is basically based on the true story of the lead up to the 1996. It was one of the worst mass killings in the world. Cale Blandry-Jones won the Best Actor Award at the Cannes Film Festival for this.
Okay,
I would say this is one of these kind of films that, like, it's, you know, quite a slow burn of a watch. And it is really, really well acted, and it's really, really well directed, and there's a lot going on, but it's the kind of film that you'll watch it once and then you'll never watch it again because it's the kind of film that it will stay with you for days afterwards and it has a lot of kind of, I don't want to say disturbing moments in it, but there's definitely a lot of moments in it where you're watching it and you're like, oh, actually, that's why that was there. So,
yeah.
I mean, I was talking to the makeup artist, who is Australian. She says, yeah, I remember it. Yeah. She remembered, like, hearing about this or whatever. And I think in the context of everything that's happened in the US recently, it definitely has taken on a different kind of edge.
Yeah,
so,
true story. I mean, listen. How did you rate this one?
I mean, like, it is really, really well acted and everything like that. I mean, I would give it like 3.5, 4 out of 5, but I would say, like, I mean, you know, you really want to be prepared for
a
very, very dark downer film, like, so.
Okay, let's end on a little bit of a brighter note.
Yeah.
Hocus Pocus 2.
I mean, we've really started up here.
Hocus Pocus.
Okay, do you know what? Hold on, we have a little VT over. Yeah. Let's take a quick look.
Okay.
Sanderson sisters.
I bet you're looking for the stage.
Always.
They're back.
All three of them are back. And, like, they've been trying to get this film going for, like, years. Like, Bette Midler was, like, desperate to do it, really, really wanted to do it. But, yeah, the whole cast are back. It's going to be on Disney Plus in time for Halloween.
Brilliant.
So, yeah, going to be interesting to
see.
My
wife loves the first. Yeah, every Halloween, this comes out. Yeah. Always the first one.
Yeah, I know, like, okay, would you watch that?
Absolutely.
Yeah, that's fine.
Anything with Bette Midler, I'm there, definitely.
Yeah. And the fact Sarah Jessica Parker as well, because obviously with Sex and the City, I'm sure she was probably the one that maybe wasn't too keen to do it, but it brings it back again.
But it's a favourite.
But it's a favourite, yeah, exactly. Like, it's a holiday favourite, like, and I think it's the kind of film that people will want to see it, like, so, yeah.
Oh, big time.
It's a big one for Disney Plus to get as well, isn't it?
I'm surprised it didn't go to cinemas. Like, people would turn up for that. You never know, like, they might decide to try put it into cinemas, but, yeah, it'll be on Disney Plus, I think, end of September, I think, is when it's on.
Brian Lloyd from entertainment.ie, thank you, as always, for joining us.
It's all over the place.
Alan, what's coming up next?
Well, up next, the Queen of Clean, Kim Fitzgerald, is here with her top tips on how to give your garden shed a summer spruce up. We'll see you in a few minutes. Thanks for staying with us. Now we're helping people declutter and organise their shed and garden spaces this morning.
Yes, she's back again with some handy hacks. It's Kim Fitzgerald from Assorted Affair. Kim, you're very, very welcome.
Good morning.
Good morning to you. And it is true, isn't it? It's like this time of year, we all start, the garden.
We forgot about that for six months
and you go out and you go, mother of God.
It is, Jenny, you're covered in spiders and God only knows what.
And then you open the garden shed and everything's been thrown and it falls
out. Everything comes on top of you.
People sometimes treat the garden shed a bit like the box room, that room where you close the door.
Yeah, or the drawer. The drawer of doom, only a shed of doom, or the box of doom, whatever it may be.
So where do you start then on keeping that? If you're serious about it, take the declutter out, and what do you put in now?
So take everything out, and we would recommend, so this is a rack zone rack, so it's a shelving unit, but it's strong, so it's made of steel.
Yeah.
And you can see that, put the shelves at whatever height you want. So generally those kind of plastic cheaper ones you can get, they're just standard sizes, so you can't really figure out. So you might get a shelf and then you discover that your box that you want to go on it won't fit. So this one you can literally measure to fit exactly what you want.
Okay, and it's so you can go from small to big.
Exactly, or exactly, so depending on, so if you've got toolboxes or if you've got, say, for instance, a box of compost or something like that, you could even a small barbecue could easily fit on here. A swimming pool. Well, you know, a deflated swimming pool.
But Alan's swimming pool would not fit on that shelf.
Simply because I don't have one. But like you're saying, that the plastic ones, just invest. If you're serious about it,
they're not that expensive. They're really.
How much would this be?
This is around €6.
But you'll have it forever.
You'll have it forever, exactly. And like they're really, really sturdy. And you know, you have to, like, safety is a big thing in sheds. I mean, generally you'll hear people let a shed at the kids, don't go in there, something's going to fall on top of your head. Or don't pull anything out because something's going to fall on top of you.
If you had two of these, one on both sides, I mean, you won't have that. Oh, everything's just packed in, you can't find anything.
Exactly.
Because isn't that the thing as well? It's to see what you have.
So it's almost like what we say when we're doing the kitchens, is to decant everything into boxes, label them. So here's the painting, here's the outdoor toys, here's the sandbox, all that kind of
stuff. And all those chemicals and weed killers that lie on the ground up on the top shelf.
Yeah,
I have it in a lazy Susan, I'm being very extra today.
We're not going to go that far.
Listen.
But the labelling now, I don't think I'd go as far as that. Would you do the labelling?
You don't have to.
No, because it's clear. If it's clear, you don't have to.
That's the idea. So at least if the kids came running in, they wanted their outdoor toys, they're not going to pull everything apart. They can see them in there and they can grab the box.
I like this little thing there. My husband has one of those for his fishing thing.
Oh, there you go.
His fishing tackle.
Yeah, fishing tackle. Don't go there.
All the little tools. A lot of homes would have a toolbox.
Yes.
But like...
Not everyone has tools. Yeah.
So you're sort of saying don't just use it for the tools.
Yeah, so
it has great use.
Think outside the toolbox. So this one I've kind of set it up for gardening. So you might be into your gardening, so you can have all your tools, your little pots, your gloves, all that kind of stuff in there. And it's great because it organises, it puts everything into compartments, neat and tidy, close it away, put it on the shelf, everything's kept safe. Because that's what happens in sheds. Things you tend to buy... Oh, there goes my brushes.
Yeah.
You tend to buy things in the summer and then they get shoved in the shed, and then by the time it comes around to the next summer they're all ruined again, or they've been, you know.
The brush that are falling there reminded me, you know, you can get those organisers for the long tools as well.
Yeah, like a broom holder. Yes. So we have a broom holder on our online shop, and you can just literally fit it to the shed. You can put it even on the door.
Yeah.
So like a lot of people stand at the shed and they look around and they're like, I don't have any space. But turn around, look up, so you can put a shelf above the door. You can put something on the back of the door. Mm. So try and kind of think outside
and
the box.
And hooks.
Hooks are brilliant. So like hooks on the wall, hooks on the ceiling, hang the gazebo up. Exactly. Yeah, exactly. Mm. Even put it, like, drill a hole in the top of the sweeping brush, tie a little bit of wire on it and hook it on the wall or hook it on the back of the shed door. So just try and look at your shed a little bit differently. So look up and look at any empty space.
And can I ask you, we were saying earlier on, I'm spending my life at the moment in and out of the garden, taking the cushions off the garden furniture, in, out, in, out.
It's a pain.
So I had, I did get these boxes, the bigger boxes.
Do you know what? It takes a lot of time to put them in the boxes, put the lid on. I have one of those large kind of bags there that you pick up in IKEA. They're really, really handy. Oh, they have a zip on top. Just shove them in, zip it up and pop it up on a high shelf or hang it up. Yeah, much quicker. Or just get a black sack. Do you know that kind of way? Get them in and get them away. If you can, get them up high. So I would try and leave some space on a high shelf just to get them up and out of the way rather than leaving them on the floor.
Because they are going to be there the whole winter.
And it needs to be quick. Like, you could be sitting there in 20-degree heat sunbathing, and then before you know it, the rain has arrived.
Yeah,
so just to be able to grab a bag like that, throw them in. And even if you had a small space, like an apartment, so you just had a balcony and you had a storage box, having lots of little plastic bags like that, pop them in and then pop everything in the storage box so you're keeping them nice and safe.
Now, we love this.
This is brilliant.
So this is a line, like, instead of having that horrible line that's in the garden that everyone can see and takes up a lot of space, you put this to the wall.
Turn it the other way.
And
then you just pop it out. Yeah. So this one fits to the wall.
That goes like that.
That way.
So
again,
goes,
Alan.
Yeah.
Constantly doing
always
laundry.
Always doing the washing.
Beside the swimming pool.
You're laughing. You're the same.
I was literally going to go, do the clothes hang down
there? I mean, you could. You could. You could be very fancy. Very fancy and take four lines for everything.
Yeah.
But yeah, really, really clever. Even, you know, the side of your house, if you really didn't want to see the washing, which
so
not everyone
does.
So
does stick to then another wall?
It just fits to the other side of the wall. So you flip it over. There's two little things
here. So
you're
in a balcony or something.
Exactly. Yeah. Sometimes in apartments you're not allowed to leave washing out or lines out, so this could be a clever alternative.
That's fantastic. Yeah. I have one of those and they're brilliant.
They're brilliant.
And you had a little, which I thought was a great idea for kids, if you are in an apartment and, you know, like in your back garden you might have a little sand pit for them. There you go. A little sand pit in a box like that.
Yeah, take it out, take the lid off, let them play, pop the lid back on and off it goes.
And in it comes
really,
back into
really
the house.
Handy. And it's protected, so it's waterproof and all that kind of stuff. So yeah, it's very clever.
Fantastic.
All these little things.
Brilliant stuff.
Sorted.
And
Thank
if
you.
People want to know more,
Assorted Affair on Instagram.
Assorted Affair on Instagram. Thank you so much for
joining
us this morning. Now it's time to announce the winner of our Malta competition. Tommy, take it away.
Thank you very much. And see that sand? My kids just tip it off. It's a disaster, I know. Now, listen, all week you have kept us entertained. We've had some laugh at some of the funniest holiday stories. But there can only be one winner of a trip to Malta, and she is on the line right now. Sarah Murta from Cork, good morning to you. Congratulations.
Morning.
We've been keeping you on the line. I don't think you knew that you had won, but you have. This story has cracked me up. Congratulations. How are you feeling?
Delighted, but really embarrassed.
I love it.
Well, do you know what? I can understand you are a bit embarrassed. Will you tell us the story?
Okay, so I was in Thailand on a kind of a summer holiday from college. It's many years ago. And we were on Koh Tao and there was lots of amazing spicy foods. And so I thought, sure, when in Rome, you know, enjoy yourself. I wasn't really accustomed to those types of foods. But anyway, 2 days later, started feeling very unwell. My tummy was not great. As my mom calls it, you have a dicky tummy. Mm. And so, yeah, I spent the next day in the bathroom and while the girls were all sunbathing on the beach, and I started feeling better, so I thought I'd go out to the beach, and about 20 minutes later it felt unwell. I was like, okay, well, better get back to the apartment. Legged it. I knew I didn't have much time. Ran back to the apartment, in the door, round the corner into the bathroom. I knew the girls were back at the beach, so I didn't have to be quiet.
You let nature take its course.
I know.
You let rip.
This is national TV. So 2 minutes later, I'm sitting there, I realise that there's toiletries I don't recognise, and men's aftershave. I knew that wasn't ours. I knew at that moment that I wasn't in the right bathroom. I realized that, and I thought, okay, look, if I can just get out of here and no one will ever notice and no one will ever hear this story ever again, But I walked around the corner of the bathroom and there was a couple sitting in the bed staring at me. I think they were German. And I didn't know what to say. I didn't know how to explain myself. They looked in shock. They didn't know what to say either. We just stared at each other for like a moment, and then I didn't know. I just ran.
I
ran.
Well, listen, left all the evidence behind. Yeah.
Well, listen, Sarah, congratulations. Thank you so much for coming on and tell us your story. Of
Sarah,
course,
you won't get a dodgy tummy in Malta. No, I promise you.
I mean, you've got, listen, flights courtesy of Shannon Airport, 4 nights, bed and breakfast in the 5-star Malta Marriott Hotel and Spa, and you 100%
enjoy.
Deserve it. For that brilliant story.
That is a great story.
I feel sorry for that poor couple. If they're watching this morning, we'd love to hear from them as well.
I love it. I just legged it. Don't even know who they are. Listen, we've had a great week. Thank you so much, Grainne,
for having me. Love being here. Thanks so much.
You have a great weekend. We'll be back on Monday. See you then. Bye-bye.
Absolutely. Thanks very much, guys.